Good morning and welcome to Emmanuel Church this Sunday morning. It is great to welcome you. We're going to begin with words from Deuteronomy 32. So I'll begin, and if you'd like to join in with the bits that say all. I will proclaim the name of the Lord. Oh, praise the greatness of our God. He is the rock. His works are perfect, and all his ways are just. A faithful God, who does no wrong. Upright and just is he. And let's join together with a prayer. Loving God, we worship you. Help us to pray to you in faith, to sing your praise with gratitude, and to listen to your word with eagerness. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, it is great to welcome you this morning, whether you're watching online or whether you're in the building. And it's really good, even though sadly we are back in lockdown and struggling with all kinds of difficulties that brings. But yet the government have said that we can still hold public worship in the building. And so if you'd like to come to the building next Sunday morning for the service, do register. Of course, if you have any COVID symptoms or you're feeling unwell in any way, please don't come along to the building, even if you have registered. But we do want to say no one is compelled to come along, of course. Now, we didn't do birthdays last week, and so we're going to do them today. So for those with a birthday in January, happy birthday. And we've got photos for Yvonne, Joseph, Ella, Renali, Andrew, and Jen. And of course, actually, we are celebrating the church's birthday today. It is our 86th birthday, 86 years since Emmanuel started up, having been planted from Christ Church, Surbiton, to reach this part of the parish. So happy birthday to everyone, and let's sing happy birthday together. So happy birthday if it is your birthday in January, and happy birthday to the whole church family. Now, you can tell it's winter because I'm filming in here. I'm not filming in the main meeting area because it's freezing in there. And so I thought I'd come in here, which is a bit easier to warm up. Now, our first song will help you if you're feeling a bit cold this morning, because there's clapping involved. So do join in with that. It's a song which reminds us of God's goodness to us, of his provision for us. Now, if you're in the building, if you're in the church building, do feel free to stand for this. And if you're at home, you could stand as well if you want, and do join in with the clapping. If you're in the church building, obviously you can't sing out loud, but if you're at home, you can. And so we're going to sing the song, Clap Your Hands.
Our God made you and me. Our God made.
every year at Emmanuel, we have a verse for the year. Now, that doesn't mean that that verse is more important than all the other verses, of course, but it's just good to be remembering verses, memorizing verses of the Bible, and to have them sort of throughout the year so that we hold on to them. And maybe you can take the verse for the year card, which you should be getting, and put it somewhere prominent, somewhere where you're going to look at it and read it and remember it. And the verse for this year is Romans 8, verses 38 and 39, which says this: "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." It's a wonderful verse, great one to remember. And so we're going to try and memorize it now. So Andrew has found some pictures to go with the different lines of this verse, which hopefully will help you remember it. So as you see the pictures, join in with the words of the verse. Here we go. "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Romans 8, verses 38 and 39. Well, now we need to see if we can remember it. So we're going to take away some of the words, and you'll just have the pictures and see if you can remember it. Okay, join in. Here we go. "For I am convinced that neither nor life, neither nor demons, neither the present nor the, nor any powers, neither height nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the of God that is in Christ our Lord." Romans 8, verses 38 and 39. Okay, let's have a look at the whole verse on one screen. Just the text, just the words, just so that you can see it, so you can check whether there are any bits that you failed to get. Okay, that's enough of that. Now, this time, we're going to remove some more of the words. You'll still have the pictures. See if you can remember it. So, join in again. "For I am convinced that neither anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the that is in 8, verses 38. Okay, now check the whole verse again. Okay, you need to look, see whether which were the bits that you didn't quite get. Okay, and now let's see how we do if we lose even more words. Here we go. "For neither, nor, neither, nor, will, from the, that is in, 8, verses 38, Okay, how did you do? It's getting harder, isn't it? Okay, check the whole verse again. Did you miss anything? Okay, now try it with hardly any words and just the pictures. Okay, now this is going to be your hardest go. Oh, before we have a go at that last one, check the verse again. Okay, anything that you missed, you've got to remember. Okay, this is going to be the hardest one. Andrew is going to put lots of distractions in. See if you can do the verse anyway. Here we go. Well done if you managed to learn the verse. If you haven't quite managed it, how about having a go during this week? Look it up and try to remember it. It's a great one to memorize. Well now, Jam and Pathfinders, you're just about to head out to your Zoom groups, but let's pray together first. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray whether we're going to Jam or Pathfinders or whether we're in the service, Father, please would you teach us, help us to understand your great love for us more and more. And would you teach us with your word, feed us with your word, and by your Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Okay, Jam, Pathfinders, off you go. And for the rest of us, we're going to have our prayers, which David and June Cruden are going to lead.
We turn now to think of the things we have done and the things we should have done. Let us say together the words on the screen. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done wrong things that hurt you. We are sorry and turn away from what we have done wrong. Have mercy because you love us. Wash away what we have done wrong and clean us from sin. Put our thoughts and hearts in line with yours and make us joyful. Because you have saved us through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Jesus tells us in Matthew 11:28, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. In these very strange times, let us come to prayer with this knowledge and certainty in our hearts.
Let us pray. We pray for our Queen Elizabeth II, for wisdom in her words and in deeds during lockdown. Pray for our government, for our Prime Minister Boris Johnson and the government, that they will make the right decisions for the whole of the UK. Pray for the Church, for our Bishop Richard Cheetham, that he will support the Church's ministers and all parishioners as we continue with tougher lockdown restrictions, and for our Minister, Bart Elbart, as he serves our community. Pray for Emmanuel and our sister church, Christ Church, as they stay open for individual prayer. Pray for scientists as the world scientists develop vaccines for the virus that will save lives so we can go back to work and socialise again. Pray for the NHS as they continue to save lives and slowly open their doors to people who need their services. Pray for those who are suffering with mental health issues that they will get the help they need. Pray for the people who are unwell with COVID-19, for cancers, heart disease and liver diseases, that God will heal them. Our mission statement this year is, our aim is to see people come to Jesus, grow in him and go out to serve him. We pray for Jean Etling's family following her death on Boxing Day. Please pray for her family and especially her nephew Stephen. And also, could we pray for wisdom for everyone involved as we prepare for interviews in February, including the three shortlisted candidates, especially with all the complications caused by COVID-19. Good also to pray for Christchurch staff and church family that they will continue to walk closely with God during this time, and that God will be preparing the person of his choice for Christchurch and will be preparing Christchurch to receive them. Amen.
Let us close by saying together the words our Lord himself taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you so much, David and June. We're now going to say a creed together. So if you're able to, please would you stand and let's declare what we believe in the words of the Apostles' Creed. And we say together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy worldwide church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We're now going to sing our next song, which focuses on God's love. That's what the verse for the year is all about, isn't it? And so we're going to sing together, How Deep the Father's Love for Us. Do stand if you're able. We're just about to have our Bible reading, but before we do, I just wanted to introduce this little sermon series that we're going to be having in January. And I've called it An Anchor in the Storm, because it does feel like we're going through a storm, doesn't it? It feels like we're little boats on the surface of the water in a huge storm. It feels like we're being buffeted around, like there is constant change, and that we aren't in control. In fact, we feel completely out of control. We have no idea what the future holds. We don't even know what tomorrow holds. How does that make you feel? Well, it can make you feel fearful. It can make you feel anxious. It can make you despair. And maybe it just makes you feel very low. And maybe some of those things are the way that you're heading into 2021. And where do we look? Well, we're being encouraged to look towards the vaccine as being the great hope. But actually, the Bible holds out something that is far greater. An anchor which is far stronger, more certain. And therefore, in this series, we're going to look at a few passages in the Bible which help us to hold on to the Lord our God as our anchor. We're looking at the verse for the year today. Next week, we are going to see the disciples in a storm. The following week, we're going to think about suffering and faith. And the week after that, we're going to think about praying our fears. And all of this with the aim of helping us to grow stronger at holding on to the Lord our God through the storms of life. And so this series, An Anchor in the Storm, we're going to start off with the verse for the year. And so we're going to have the passage that verse is in. And Joan Mayhew is going to read that for us.
Today's reading is Romans chapter 8, verses 31 to 39. Please follow along in your Bibles at home or at church. Romans 8, beginning at verse 31. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God, and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble, or hardship, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, let's pray together as we come to God's word. Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for your word, which is breathed out by you. And we pray, please, that your spirit would teach us as we look at your word, that the truths we read wouldn't just go into our heads, but into our hearts and change the way we live. Amen. We're going to focus in on verses 38 and 39. I thought it was important, though, that we have the reading from earlier on so that you can see the context, and we will refer to that later on. But we're going to focus in on verses 38 and 39. And clearly, these verses are all about God's love, and that Paul is saying we are inseparable from God's love. Maybe you're familiar with teaching about God's love. Maybe you've heard about God's love for years, maybe since you were a child in Sunday school. You've heard about God's love over and over again, and you've sung about God's love. We sang about it earlier in how deep the Father's love for us. Maybe you sang it with conviction just now. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure. But what does it take to shake your confidence in God's love? Actually, it can take relatively little, can't it, if we're honest? I mean, I know it can for me. What does it take on a Monday morning for you to start to doubt that God loves you? Well, sometimes it can be a bit pathetic, can't it, actually? That you wake up late and you have to rush around, and then you lose your car keys, and then you find that there are pressures in your work, and then, oh, something else goes wrong. Maybe, your washing machine breaks down. And you just have a series of events where you go, one thing after another, and you get to a point where you just think to yourself, God, if you love me, would these things really be happening? And maybe, of course, it can be big things that happen in our lives, major changes. Don't they knock us? Aren't there times where you doubt God's love? Oh, you've heard it so many times before, you've sung it with conviction, but on a Monday morning, actually, we can doubt, can't we? Which shows that we don't really know this truth as well as we should. And we've got a choice at those times. Are we going to listen to ourselves and our doubts? Or are we going to trust God's word? And specifically, Romans 8, 38 and 39. Paul starts this verse with, "For I am convinced." Now that's quite something. Paul is saying, here is something that is rock solid. Here is an anchor that is firm, that is sure, that is strong. I am convinced of this. What's he convinced of? That nothing can separate him from God's love, or any other Christian. And we do need to see here that this isn't a love which is just God's general love for creation. And we are reassured of that. In the Old Testament, in the book of Psalms, Psalm 145 talks about God's love for all that he has made. But that's not this love. This love is a love that God has for Christians. That's what the context tells us. It's talking about those for whom Christ died. You see that in verse 32. It's those for whom Christ intercedes. Or earlier in the chapter, it's those who've got the Holy Spirit. In other words, this is Christians, those who've got faith. This love is the love that God has for those people. Now, that is a love which is available to any who will put their trust in Christ. But it is important to see that if that's not you, if you're not a Christian, then these truths in verse 38 and 39 are not actually true for you. But if you do, if you're a Christian, this truth is so important that we hold on to it, that nothing can separate you from God's love. And so we're going to think about these verses in two parts. The first is the contenders. So Paul lines up the contenders. It's like he's saying, look, here's a list of things which maybe could challenge to see whether they can separate you from God's love, but none of them succeed. And so he starts with death. Now that's a pretty big contender, isn't it? Quite a strong contender, because we fear death, don't we? And we think, well, maybe death, maybe that could be something that could get between you and God's love. And when you hear of someone who is dying, do you wonder, well, maybe that shows that God's love has turned away somehow? But that's not the case. Paul's saying death doesn't come between us and God. I mean, before death, as someone is dying, as they die, and then after they die, Paul is saying there is no break in God's love. The beam of God's love is on that person. If they're a Christian, the beam of God's love is constant. There is no flickering, no dimming. His love isn't turned away at all. God's love is utterly constant. Death does not get between us and God's love. Now that should mean that we as Christians, we don't need to fear death. The world does, doesn't it? That's why we're in lockdown, why there are so many restrictions, because the world is terrified of death and of dying. And yes, we should obey what the government tells us to do. But don't buy into the fear. Death cannot get between a Christian and God's love. Second contender is life. So he says, for I am convinced that neither death nor life, by which Paul means, well, presumably all the events of life, all the calamities of life, the ups and particularly the downs. And there can be a lot of downs, can't there? Illnesses, viruses, job losses, mental illness, all kinds of trials that we might go through. And Paul is saying all of life, all of the calamities, all of the events, none of them can get between you and God's love if you're a Christian. And none of them, therefore, are indicators that God loves you any less. None of them. What does he come to next? Well, we're going to take them in pairs from now on. It says, neither angels nor demons. Now, demons is not a great translation there. It should really be rulers. That's what it says. In other words, we're dealing here with all the sort of cosmic superhuman agencies, all the big powers that you might think of. This is powers in the spiritual realm, things that are far more powerful than us. And Paul is saying, none of them can get between a Christian and God's love. They are just not powerful enough. Maybe you've said in the past, when you're going through particular sufferings, you've said, well, maybe this is the devil doing this to me, causing me to suffer. Now, we do need to be careful here because the devil is real and he is powerful and he does attack the church and he can cause temptations and sufferings. But we need to remember his power is limited. And even when he causes sufferings and problems, it is all under God's sovereignty, and therefore God works good for his people, even through what the devil will do. So the devil cannot get in the way of God's love for you. No spiritual power can. What's next? Neither the present nor the future. Well, clearly we're dealing with time here, isn't it? Paul is saying nothing now, nothing that can happen to you now, and nothing that will happen in the future can get between a Christian and God's love. We can feel very uncertain about the future, can't we? We don't know. We can't feel that we can plan things even for the coming year. Everything is up in the air. But there is one certainty. You could turn to any page in your diary for 2021. You could go further ahead than that. 2022, 2032, 2052, 2072. You could go to the year 3000. You could go way beyond and you could say, yes, every single day, every moment in that time, as it stretches on for the future forever, God's love for you will be constant. There will be nothing in the future that can get between a Christian and God's love. What's next? Nor any power. This is kind of the forces of the universe. It's like Paul is saying, well, if you can imagine, the biggest forces that there could possibly be, they are not powerful enough to get between a Christian and God's love. The next things, neither height nor depth. If we've dealt with time, now we're dealing with space. You cannot get to the highest point or the lowest depth that means that you can get away from God's love for a Christian. The heights and the depths cannot separate you from God's love. And then the last is a catch-all. Nor anything else in all creation. Or better translation, nor any created thing. Now, we need to remember, don't we, that there are two categories of people, of thing in the universe. There is what's created, and then there's the creator. And, the creator, well, that's God. And then everything else has been created. And so Paul is saying, no other created thing, in other words, nothing at all, can get between you and God. So, those are the contenders. And none of them are powerful enough, big enough to get between a Christian and God's love. So, Christian, nothing separates you from God's love. And therefore, nothing that happens can mean God loves you any less. No sickness, no redundancy, no rejection, no depression, health problems, cancer, struggles for you, struggles for your family. Even if we end up in hospital this year, even if we die, none of them separate a Christian from God's love. The beam of God's love is an absolute constant. No flickering, no dimming. God loves his people. Why is Paul so confident of this? Well, for that, we need to turn to our second point, which is God's love. You see, we need to make sure that we read through right to the end of the verses, don't we? It says, verse 39, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And that ending is really important. It doesn't just end with the love of God, but it's the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And to understand that, we need to know what Paul has already been saying in the book of Romans, because that is quite a loaded term. What is the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord? Well, chapters 1 to 3 of the book of Romans have explained that all of mankind has rejected God, has rebelled against God, and therefore deserves God's wrath, God's anger. But God doesn't leave us in that situation, facing his wrath, but sends Jesus. And in chapter 5, verse 8, Paul says this, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And that is the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. That Jesus came and died for us. And Romans chapter 5 really makes an emphasis on the fact that he came and died while we were still sinners, while we were God's enemies. And it says people don't do that. People don't love other people and sacrifice for other people who are their enemies, maybe for their friends, but not for their enemies. But God does. And Jesus came and died for those who are sinners. And that is the love of God in Christ Jesus. Now, why is that love expressed in that way indestructible? Why is it that no one can separate us from that love? Well, because that love deals with the one thing that could separate us from God's love. What separates us from God's love? Well, it's our rebellion against God. It's our sin. It's our wrongdoing. But Jesus, when he came and died, died for sin, to deal with our sin, to be the atoning sacrifice for our sin, as Paul puts it earlier in Romans. And so if he has dealt with sin, that is the barrier gone, isn't it? And so we see, beginning of chapter 8, it says this, therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. If you've trusted in Christ, God's wrath is dealt with. The condemnation is gone. And also, Paul says, not just that the one barrier that could get in the way of you between you and God's love has dealt with, but also this shows the depths of God's love. So he dwells on this in chapter 8, verse 31 and 32. He says, what then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, and we know he is, who can be against us? Well, no one. It says, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? In other words, if Jesus came and died for us, if God gave his only son to die for you and me, then he wouldn't spare anything for us. There's nothing he wouldn't give for us. Now that's staggering, isn't it? If you're a Christian, there is nothing God wouldn't do for you. There's nothing he wouldn't give. He's already given the most precious thing he's got for you. And this is why Paul says he has such confidence. It's because of the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so Paul's saying, look, where are you going to look to know whether God loves you or not? Don't look at your circumstances. Don't look at your bank balance. Don't look at your medical records. Look at the cross. Look at the cross of Jesus. That is where we see the depths of God's love for us. That's where we see the only barrier dealt with. And so what difference will this make? Well, we need to keep dwelling on God's love, don't we? Keep understanding it better. Because we don't know it as well as we should. We keep listening to the lies, don't we? We keep listening to ourselves when we think, maybe God doesn't love me that much. No, here is the anchor for your soul. It can transform you and me. For those who will come to Jesus and trust in him, there is absolute assurance that God's love for you will never fail and nothing can get in the way of it. And so you can have confidence as you look at the year ahead. Whoever you are, if you'll come to Jesus, if you'll put your trust in him, you can have confidence as you look to the year ahead. If you're already a Christian, you can look with confidence to the year ahead, can't you? Oh, we don't know what it'll hold in lots of ways. We don't know what joys or sorrows. It may be a hard year. But the beam of God's love for you in Christ Jesus will never, ever diminish. And even the difficulties are in some way an expression of God's love for you. How? Well, we're going to think about that more next week and the following week. But the assurance is this. Today, this week, this year, you will not experience anything other than the love of God in Christ Jesus. I'm going to finish for us with a couple of lines from a hymn, which kind of express the way maybe that we should be looking at this year in the light of these verses. A couple of lines from the hymn, God Moves in a Mysterious Way. I think I've quoted them for you before. They say this, ye fearful saints, fresh courage take. The clouds ye so much dread are big with mercy and will break with blessings on your head. Well, will you trust that? If you're not yet a Christian, will you come to Jesus and put your trust in him? And if you are a Christian, will you look at this year in the light of these verses? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we praise you for your great love expressed in the Lord Jesus, poured out as he died for us on the cross to deal with sin. And Father, we pray for those who aren't yet believers that they would put their trust in Jesus and come to know this great love. And for those of us who are, Father, please would this truth of your love sink more deeply into our hearts and change the way we think and the way we live. Amen. We're going to sing our last song. It's not that hymn, but it is a wonderful song about God's love. Here is love, vast as the ocean.
The flood with the prince of life. I
Thank you for joining us for our service this morning. Can I encourage you to be phoning one another, be in touch with one another? Entering lockdown again, I'm sure many of us are feeling low, struggling maybe, and it'd be really good to be in touch with one another, just to see how we're doing and chat to one another. Do, as I said earlier, register if you'd like to join us next Sunday morning in the building. And do try and remember those verses, Romans 8 verses 38 and 39, see if you can memorize them for next time. And so let's close our service with a prayer. Let's pray the grace together. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.